Köszönöm mindenkit, Sárosi Péter vagyok, jogriporter alapítvány munkatársa, és ahogy a Stefi említette, 10 éven keresztül a TASZ-nak voltam a drogpolitikai programvezetője. A ma délutáni kerekasztal beszélgetésen, mivel a panelistáknak a többsége az angol nyelven beszél, ezért angolul fogok én is beszélni, de természetesen minden résztvevő eldöntheti, hogy milyen nyelvet használ. Tolmácsaink voltak olyan kedvesek, és ők lefordítják. Ezen kívül azt is szeretném még megemlíteni, hogy a közönségből, hogyha bárkinek közbe adódik kérdése, hozzávetése, ami fontos, akkor emelje fel a kezét, és akkor megadjuk neki a szót. Remélem, hogy valamelyik munkatárs majd oda tudja neki vinni a mikrofont. So, I've been working on this field for more than 10 years. And Tomas, you were talking about the window of opportunity, that it's very important to use the window of opportunity. And I truly feel that these years we have a window of opportunity, even in our region, in Central and Eastern Europe, to make the access to medical cannabis use legal. And what we can see, the developments not only in the Czech Republic, but also we can see some positive developments in Poland, in Macedonia, even in Serbia, so even more socially conservative countries than Hungary itself. So that shows us that this is really possible, even in our region. And it's very unfortunate that the Ministry of Health is not representing itself at this panel. We hope that in the next conference we will be able to involve the government. But I think this is the first step in a very important road. And there is a saying that to solve a problem, the first step is to make the problem visible. And I think this conference was a really effective way to make this problem visible. And also there is a growing public discussion in Hungary about medical cannabis. Just a few days ago, one of the most popular Hungarian TV channels just aired a show on medical cannabis, interviewed several professionals, and even one patient was speaking in a TV show. So something is going on. So I think we can use this momentum. First of all, there's a lot of discussion about evidence in this topic, and the main argument against the medical use of cannabis is that we don't have conclusive scientific evidence. Everybody agrees that there is some evidence, but there is a disagreement about how conclusive is the evidence, what is the conclusion we can make out of this evidence. So I ask all of you, what's your view on this subject?
Yeah. Hello, everybody. Thank you for providing me this opportunity to participate in this very good discussion. As a clinical researcher, I would like to say that I had conducted a lot of clinical trials, especially in the field of neuropsychiatric disorders. So I would like to say that we obviously need evidences, but our evidences should be collected with the proper way and should be analyzed properly. So we should not wait tons of years until we will collect all data concerning medicinal uses of cannabis. Well, we know that cannabis is already working, so we need to, now in current way, we are changing the paradigm from so-called evidence-based medicine, we are going to practice lead medicine, practice-based medicine. So our practice is going us with good existing evidences. We have more than 500 documented cases for childhood epilepsy. What else we need? What else we need to say that is helpful, that it probably should be used widely? We just need to learn more deeply, how to fit this particular strain or this particular form of administration to each particular patient. This is what we need to do in our trials. So we have a lot of observational trials. What kind of other evidences we should have in order to allow, even in Israel, where we we are proud to have a very promoted medicinal cannabis. We do not have epilepsy as a lawful indication. Each case is being under review of our authorities. So we need to change the paradigm. So, and I really hope that it will be done in the next 10 years. Thank you.
I'm not in the clinical practice anymore for last 12 years, only in research. There's a few other comments. I mean, one of the issues I'm actually professional in and I'm teaching my students is scientific methodology. And so first of all, I'm teaching my students science is never conclusive. Full stop. I mean, we are just trying to approach to some ideal which we know we will never approach. And we are never conclusively approving something. We are just testing something which is seen as good as long as it actually the hypothesis is not rejected. So there's an internal actually controversy or inconsistency in medical bureaucracy demanding conclusive research. It doesn't exist. There might be some conclusions which do respect the recent knowledge or scientific knowledge, and then I think we need to divide this into two or three different questions, right? One is, should it be allowed? And then I'm pretty much, I mean, to people to be treated with medical cannabis and preparations made of it, and should the government guarantee the quality of the product? Do we have enough evidence? And my question is, 100% we do. I mean, there's enough evidence that it does work, as Lumir usually says, for certain patients, in certain conditions, for certain illnesses, but it does. And those people shouldn't be prevented from their right for the best medical care. Full stop. I mean, then there's question number two. I mean, is it superior to some other treatments? Well, my personal opinion, being like earned from reading through thousands of papers, most probably yes, for some patients in certain conditions, in certain stages of their illnesses. Should those people be covered by medical insurance? Yes. And then there's number three question. Is cannabis, based on the available evidence, treating certain conditions or many conditions causally? Is it curing them? And then my answer, unfortunately, is so far we can't say this, and we can't use this as a curative treatment. However, we should open the research because I personally do believe it will, and it will be a medical revolution, and we should make this happen as quickly as we can. However, coming back to your previous question, so I don't think we need much of new research, I mean, to make people, to allow people to get treated. I mean, it doesn't make any sense to me from a point of view of medical professional, from a point of view of citizen, from the ethical point of view, and from the point of view of scientist.
Köszönöm szépen. Elhangzott, hogy paradigmaváltásra lehetne szükség. Jelenleg azonban ez az evidenciákon alapuló orvoslás nálunk a követendő példa. Kérdés, hogy megkapják-e a betegek. Én egyértelműen azt tudom mondani, hogy most van erre lehetőség, ezt meg kellene ragadni, tehát nem maradnak kezeletlenül a betegek egy kellően alátámasztott indokolás esetén, és a Magyarország hatóságának a törvényeket be kell tartani jelenleg ez a jogszabályi környezet, tehát nekünk ehhez kell igazodni.
I just would like to stress one thing that Ilya said about waiting and time. And I'm not a medical professional, and I don't have any scientific background. But from what I see, from the people who contact me, There are some people who come to me for these people. I don't know if you can say this in English, but yesterday was already late for them. Some of these patients already passed away, and I just really don't understand that why is always all this waiting for. When, as far as I understand, patients' rights include that a person can decide what kind of treatment they want to use. So I think maybe they should be given this right, especially in very serious cases.
You would just add that when we talk about evidence-based medicine, we're talking about two things. One is safety, the safety profile of a substance, and the next is efficacy. And in the United States, we've been running a grand experiment that now includes, I would say, closer to 3 million people that are using cannabis on a daily basis. And no one has died. No one has ever died from cannabis. The sky hasn't fallen. Elementary children aren't going around smoking cannabis, right? We actually have data now to see what the safety profile is. And on the efficacy, I think it's how we approach talking about these medications. I think it's very dangerous when people talk about curing cancer and approach, you know, bring cannabis to patients as, you know, not using traditional methods and only using cannabis. I think some of those approaches are dangerous. But for efficacy and, you know, the evidence, while it's not traditionally evidence-based approach, we have the evidence sitting right here. We had a parent in the room that she sees the evidence in her child every day. And I think what we're approaching with cannabis medicines is actually a paradigm shift that we're actually talking about. Instead of having one pill that can only meet a certain number of the population, that cannabis offers us a chance to really look at personalized medicine. And like a diabetic has issues with insulin in their body, when you're using cannabis medicines, you're actually regulating the endocannabinoid system. So you're actually trying to find a balance, and that balance is as unique as your fingerprint. And so I think as we look at how we're going to get this medicine to the millions of patients that could use it, I think we're going to learn from the scientific method and from other ways that we've brought other pharmaceutical drugs to market, but we're going to be creating a new path. And that path can be frustrating for doctors because it means listening to patients, which isn't always easy for doctors. It's a new pathway for patients because it means participating in their own healthcare. So it doesn't mean just say, thank you for the pill, I'm good, but actually paying attention to what's happening in your body. It's a new way to approach medicine for patients. And it means working with bureaucratic systems to create a new pathway for these medicines.
Cannabis is officially used as medicine today only as palliative medicine. At some diseases, it's successful around 80% or more than 80%. At some diseases, around 90%. So why I tell every time, not every time, not everybody, not every disease, not every stage of disease? Because I don't want to give false hope to this 10% of patients. So these 10% patients, they must take in, they don't know if they are in this 10%. So they must take in consideration that maybe it is not going to help them. So, and if they fall to this around 90%, so they will be very happy. If it's curative, it will be in the future. This we know only from patients. There are some successes when they treat themselves with cannabis which they cultivated or bought on black market, and it's not through physicians. But every time when I heard such successful cases, and I talk with some healers which treat patients illegally, say, so I every time tell them, first tell me unsuccessful cases. After that, tell me successful cases, because we must be fair play.
Well, speaking with them too, and you know, I mean, this publication bias is great. Just two issues. I mean, there's what I probably didn't say clearly. So when medical bureaucrats ask for conclusive science, it usually means forget it. The other way, how to say this. And this should be prevented clearly. Also, we speak about the other paradigm. I think there's another paradigm needed for science, but I don't think it's needed for the medical regulation. I mean, this is the herbal medicine. What we just see in my country and other countries is an effort to create some special group of medical products which would be called cannabis, which will be a little bit of herbal medicine with the criteria of molecular medicine or whatever you call it, and having and trying to put it on them, knowing that in the current stage or phase of knowledge about what actually really happens within the plant, it's impossible. I mean, Lumir would correct me probably, but we have something like 163 cannabinoids, and if okay, so another paper of Lumir was just published, so there's more of them since yesterday, but plus another 800 other substances, flavonoids, terpenoids, all together 1,000, and there will be more of them. And so scientifically, I think that the idea to understand the interactions between 1,000 plus substances and the interaction, how this, which does this have to the body, substance by substance, is next to impossible, definitely in whatever decades. However, I mean, we used St. John's wort, Třezalka in Czech, for treating depression. And nobody really wants, I mean, the producers or those who pick it up on the meadows of Tatry and whatever, Balaton, I mean, to have like knowledge about every single molecule in the St. John's wort, etc. It's used. I mean, people use it for the depression. They just know, don't go to the sun because it might have some consequences you won't like, and especially the girl you like doesn't like, won't like it. That's it. So take it as a herbal medicine, which is psychoactive, similar to the plant I was just speaking about. Make some safety criteria, allow people to use it, and then in the scientific whatever, ivory towers, we should speak about, okay, what about this entourage paradigm? I mean, what does it really mean? I mean, how we will, you know, is strength enough, blah, blah, blah. But it's our two separate discussions. I mean, don't make it easy for bureaucrats to torpedo actually everything we do.
Steph already mentioned this cannabis cures cancer issue, and if you open the web, you find tons of videos and articles claiming that cannabis cures cancer. So maybe in the audience, not everybody knows what is the background of this, and I would like to ask you, the panelists, if you can explain what's the science behind that.
Well, I'm a physician, but you are in the field for last 300 years or something. anyway, there's a lot of cases, not really case studies. I mean, cases, personal evidences of relatives, etc., showing cases where people objectively were diagnosed with cancer. They did a lot of things. There was usually something like meeting the doctors, not being happy with what they did with them, not da-da-da-da-da. Then meeting someone, usually not using herbal cannabis, but most of the cases which I know from the Facebook and other social networks is this Rick Simpson oil / Phoenix tears / 1 million of other names, which is basically very concentrated extract from cannabis, usually with 80 plus percent of THC, 10 something CBD, and the whole rest, not very stable. I'm not that much surprised because, I mean, we know that the cannabinoid receptors are everywhere in the body, and the cannabinoids are directly involved in the apoptosis, right, which is the death of the cell. And if I make it very simplified, cancer is a cell which went mad and refused to die and then killed the rest with growing and growing. So there's a logic behind, but there's no scientific evidence. I mean, what these healers do, when I'm speaking with them, and one of them is a very close friend, but we argue all the time long, Hindrich, some of you know him, I'm telling what you do is a carpet bombing of the cannabinoid system. And it might work, it might not work. There's a publication bias already mentioned by Lumiere. Again, there's a little bit of clinical research about the glioma, the brain tumor, already kind of... It's an analytical study, it's not a clinical trial, it's matched controls study. Basically what was done, very low number of people, 15, 20, I think 20 controls, 15. But there's emerging evidence of this very promising strain of research. And I think as a last resort, it should be allowed to everyone. But the medical doctors can't work with this in the clinical setting simply because it's not evidence-based, and whatever they do must be. I mean, that's what we swear to. However, it's very promising, and I said, when it happened close to me, the first thing I did, that it was a cancer of in the fourth stage of a stomach, which is basically, the medicine is very unsuccessful in this, illegally obtained this for my friend, and he died, but I think he died much more calmly than he would without it. Full stop.
I'm also not cancer researcher, and in my opinion, cannabis should be considered, like Lumiere said, as a palliative medicine. So it's not curative medicine till now, but it could be used not as alternative medicine, because I don't like this word alternative. So this puts us to conclusion, or this, not. It could be complementary medicine to a treatment we suggest to oncological patients, but it should be available as a first or second line, depends on patient's choice and their knowledge, and patients should have their own rights to decide what kind of treatment they could desire for their treatment. They should have an informed consent and acknowledgeable way to decide how they would like to fight their disease, with doctors, with their assistants, but putting in our armamentarium also cannabis available with very good quality and for the reasonable prices that could be affordable for all kinds of the patients. I suppose this our role, this role of such meetings, in order to put it on the agenda of the society, how we would like to treat these patients, not like palliative on the last stages of disease, because in Israel, now cannabis is allowed only for oncological patients on the fourth stage of the cancer, like before they're dying. It's just ridiculous, and we hope that it will be changed in your country. I hope that it will be changed from very beginning, putting this to the acknowledgement of your authorities. It should be available the first or second line of treatment. Thank you.
The other important.
I can start with healthy persons. You know, there are families that everybody at this family dies at age around 50. So if you are from such family, you cannot expect, even if you live a healthy life, that you will live up to 90. And our families, that everybody lives up to 90, and if in family somebody who doesn't follow a healthy style of life, so have good chance that live much more longer than this from family 50. So it means...
You can't say this publicly.
So it depends also on your genes, and this is also with cancer, because are different type of cancer. Some you can treat better, some it's harder to treat, and the same with cannabis. With cannabis, some types of cancer are treated easier, some harder. So it is not only that you have correct strain of cannabis and that you do everything correctly, but it's important also background of your family, your genes. So it's more complicated than we think.
No, at the end, I mean, sorry
to intervene, two sentences. I mean, at the end, I mean, the ideal state of art would be that the medical science would be able to combine specific phenotype rather than genotype of human with a specific probably metabolon of not really the strain of the plant and the certain illness, but we are far from that, and so far we have to work with what we have.
No, of course they are working on that in the future it will not be that the physician tells you three times a day one pill and doesn't matter if your weight is 50 kilo or 150. Yeah. In the future will be simply prepared medicine just for you, and this is the future of treatment.
Yeah, I just want to also to say that they're that saying the word cancer is like saying country, right? There are hundreds of types of cancer, and we actually have only seen in petri dishes cannabis kill a few types of cancers. So it's not just the type of plant, but it's also the type of cancer. So one thing we definitely know is that someone who's going through traditional treatments for cancer, it breaks down their ability to for their cells, other cells to reproduce and function. You know, people lose their appetite, and so they are not well. So cannabis as an adjunct therapy going through traditional treatments, we definitely know that there's a better result. Anytime, you know, I've actually watched many loved ones go through chemotherapy, and the difference when they have cannabis as a part of that regimen is just, it's undeniable, right? They're healthier, they're able to eat, they're able to withstand the poison that's being put in their body to fight the cancer. So again, with as far as what we know, I think there's a lot of opportunity, there's a lot of possibilities. And as loved ones of mine have gotten cancer diagnosis, I've definitely done everything I could to get them cannabis and cannabis treatments. But I also didn't interfere with their traditional treatment as well.
Sorry, that the round table means that it is open for the audience also. So I would like to ask you to involve Professor Csupor, because you don't want to... Sorry. Yeah, yes, I know. Sorry.
He was the next one on my list.
Yes. I would like to ask Professor Sendrej to tell something about it.
Thank you. Well, on this issue of cancer treatment, I think if you raise the question like this, whether cannabis cures cancers, I think the answer is no. At this time, we have no evidence, really clear-cut evidence. But we already agree that in most treatment options, cannabis is a curative, and not a curative, but a symptomatic treatment. Treating with cannabis, it's symptomatic, relieving certain unpleasant symptoms and difficult symptoms. Now, with cancer, this is valid for the whole range of symptoms, from the appetite, an immune system maybe also. If it is a mixed cannabis, then the dial may have, I don't know exactly, but there is a lot of reference that it improves the answer. And then through the central effects, also anxiety relieves anxiety of the patient, and so on and so on. So there is no doubt in my mind that in a kind of combination therapy, but the patient should be convinced that he or she follows the treatment that the oncologist has asked her or him to follow, and then as a combination therapy, it might be very useful, an additional therapy to improve the quality of life of the patient. And the later stages, the better, probably. So I think there is no question in my mind on that.
not because cannabis is such a wonderful drug, but it has certain clear-cut pharmacological effects which are useful in this particular case. So that's it. Well, I'm not sure I have a few other points or questions. I think one key question, a key point is still the involvement of the medical profession, which you may discuss later on, but I'm not sure I will have enough time. And then also training and education. I think you mentioned education in a critical way, wasn't it? No, I refuse that. So you are not right. You are incorrect. We are educating medical students and pharmaceutical students. We have been doing that for almost 20 years, including cannabis's potential medical uses, obviously in a careful and critical way. But that doesn't mean there is no education. There is a lot of education. I am the responsible for that seminar. In Szeged, we are certainly doing that and have been doing for a long time. Now, second, a small correction for all those who don't know, GW Pharmaceuticals, Sativex. I was the first lecturer, actually, to present the paper of GW Pharmaceuticals in Szeged at the Academy of Sciences. They asked me to present it when Sativex was just being approved. So, there is some impression that it is a very recent. This was more than 10 years ago, before Sativex was approved. Thank you.
Okay, so let's turn to the issue of how to make the medical professionals interested in the medical use of cannabis. And we know that there is a legal framework for doctors in Hungary to order medical cannabis products from other countries, but nobody used it so far in Hungary. So according to your experiences from other countries, what are the best ways and methods to educate medical professionals? What can we do in Hungary to do that in a better way?
So education of physicians has actually been the biggest challenge in the United States until recently. I mentioned earlier that we've now started working with Dr. Stephen Korn of the Answer Page, which is a project of Harvard University, where we've actually created 25 hours of continuing medical education courses that are backed by the American Medical Association. I think the challenge for us in the past was that there wasn't what a doctor would say, a credible source, that there's different types of education for doctors, and there's definitely the highest level, which is in the US is the American Medical Association, and then there are other organizations under that. And so this is actually a new phenomenon for us to be able to, instead of having patients try to educate their doctors, which I know we all try, but it can be a challenge, having doctors educate doctors. And finding doctors that can bring this continuing medical education into hospitals, into doctor groups. And so I think that there's an opportunity for Hungary that hasn't been available for any other country. I mean, there really has been a gap of credible education. And so I think the one of the projects that Tomasz and I are working on through International Cannabis and Cannabinoid Institute is actually bringing that doctor education and translating it and working with medical institutions in those countries to bring that education. So it's I think the challenge has just been that patients have been bringing this information and doctors didn't want to listen and that they needed to hear from their other colleagues. And so luckily that information is available.
Thank you, Steph. So, Thomas, can we bring this initiative to Hungary?
Well, I mean, I'm part of this, but I'm always saying, and this is based on the experience of introducing another, in that time, novel treatment, a substitution treatment in the Czech Republic, 15, almost 20 years ago. The only thing which really works for doctors, in my eyes, is to bring them to see it does happen. I mean, the theory is great, but if they are not lazy, they can read it somewhere else. However, many of them are pretty much like feeling unsure, feeling a little bit endangered as well, because their responsibility to their patients is quite high, and they can be actually being brought to the responsibility. But I remember pretty nicely, and this might be like a distant example, it took 5 or 6 years, the prison system, the medical prison system in my country, to persuade them that the substitution treatment using methadone and buprenorphine in the prisons is normal, it's beneficial. We never succeeded, but then we succeeded somehow to take them and to bring them to Austrian biggest prison, just to speak with the other doctors who do this for 15 years and to understand this is no evil, this is no hell, it actually makes life easier for both doctors and their patients. Then it took 6 months and we had it in the Czech Republic in the prisons. And I think this is an important part which is very often omitted, that everybody says theory, you need to understand this, you need to understand this, you need to understand this. And I said, no, you need to see your partner, your colleague, neurologist, algaziologist, internal medicine doctor, to do this life at large. To stay in the hospital for a week or more, to understand what he does, to speak with the patients, to understand what it really does in your medical practice, and to bring it home, to try and maybe to teach your peers, and that's it.
Are the study tours funded by the government in Czech Republic?
Yeah, having an Israeli next to me, we are already for almost a year striving, fighting, asking, betting. We have even a promise of Benjamin Netanyahu, actually, that Israel will host some 15 medical workers to teach them, but when you go lower in the bureaucracy, it was more and more difficult. So as I said in my presentation, now it seems by the end of the summer, we would have something like 15, 20 people in the clinics of Israel in Tel Aviv, Jerusalem, Lumir's Hospital and others, actually to speak with their peers, plus having 3 days of theory, which I think they don't need, but the Israeli government wants us to have it, why not? Doesn't harm.
Okay, Ilya, please.
I fully agree with Tomas that I'm really skeptical about the ability of Israeli Medical Association to provide a good quality course of practical cannabis treatment, because this association resists during the last 10 years to any introduction of cannabis for mainstream of medical treatment. So it had been made by members of our forum for medicinal cannabis. I coordinate this forum. This is just dozens of doctors in Israel. We are fully responsible for thousands of patients. You should understand this. And we are just crushing under the pressure of new cases, and we are really in trouble to obtain new licenses, because authorities are saying you are overcrowded, you are overloaded, and they're absolutely right, because majority of the doctors just do not support our efforts. This is why very important to speak with the doctors on the level of the eyes, on the doctor levels, doctor to doctors, and I fully agree with Tomas, it should be done in the practical manner, saying the patients, saying the good cases, saying not successful cases. We should understand to whom it could be fit and to whom it should not be fit. So we also should understand, like Lumir saying, please bring me unsuccessful cases. And this we will understand better to whom we should not suggest this treatment. It will bring us much more stable condition to our practice. This is what we need to fight, four generations demonization of cannabis in the doctor's brain, otherwise we could not bring it to the mainstream. So we just now in process, it's slowly going in Israel, we hope we could bring our positive experience together with general experience to the Czech Republic, because we have a very good collaboration in general, but I hope we could be able to spread our experience in other countries, like in Macedonia, like in Hungary, hopefully. Thank you.
This thing was so. What to tell you? Patient is sick, and cannabis can help him, but it's not enough, because
patient must also believe that it will help him. He tells you, oh, it will be helpful, but inside think, no, it cannot help me. So it's first minus, which makes treatment harder. And then also can be placebo effect. At some diseases, placebo effect can be up to 30%. It can be also very helpful. And physicians, it's very important that physicians is also psychologist, because it can be very helpful to the patients. You know, many patients tell you, oh, I went to physician, family physician, okay, he prescribed me what I wanted, but it's terrible physician, you know. Approach to the patient, it's very important, because it can also treat patients. So not only medicine, but everything together.
Okay. And the other key issue is how to mobilize the patients in Hungary, and we have some positive developments in this respect, but we still face a lot of stigma and fear, and most patients just don't want to, you know, come out from the closet. And as we see with all kinds of marginalized groups, this kind of coming out can really move forward a cause. So I ask particularly Steph, like, what were your strategies to mobilize the patients?
Well, I'll say the same is true in the U.S. For most patients. I mean, the truth is, I don't, unless there's a doctor sitting in the room, I don't think about myself as a patient. It's not the way I would describe myself as a human being, right? So I think that we actually have used lots of strategies. One is that once someone actually has been arrested and there is a legal, there's a case moving forward, those patients are usually more likely to speak out because they're already in the legal system. It's not something to hope for, but the way that we find those patients is that we offer resources. So if you go to our website, patients can find information about their condition, information that they can download and give to their doctors, information that they can download and give to their family members and other people that are involved in their care. And I think bringing, you know, having a place where patients can get that information is going to start organizing them. And you know, finding, I mean, it's there's sort of really basic levels of organizing, of getting people's email address, keeping them involved. And like most, I think, social issues, you know, yes, we have 100,000 members, but there are 300 million people in the United States. And with that small membership, we've been able to do a lot. So what I would say, don't set your expectations too high of what you need, the number of patients you need to actually affect change. You're looking for more quality than quantity, and that truly there's always just a few activists or you know, advocates that are doing most of the work, unfortunately. But I would say the number one thing, if you want patients to come to you, is offer them a resource. When you're going to MS organizations or cancer organizations, show them that you have a resource for their membership, right? So when we approached MS Society or Epilepsy Foundation, we didn't just say, hey, you should be working on this too. We instead say, we know that this issue is coming up for your constituents, and here's some information that you can give to them so you don't have to reinvent the wheel. But it definitely takes time.
Thank you. Any lessons learned in Israel or Czech Republic about organizing the patients or how to work with patient organizations?
Well, I'm not sure how to work with patient organizations, and I definitely don't want to speak about it in front of Steph. It's like, you know, to speak in the middle of the sea with a fisher. How to catch the fish, but what I know, what works when it comes to patients and the presentation to media, or did work in the Czech Republic, is to show the majority, which can benefit, and these are elderly people. I mean, I can even send you a few like stories from the Czech TV with the brave old lady saying, this is the hell what I do. Last 40 years, it helped me immensely, and I do want to see a policeman who's gonna to prohibit me to do this. Send him. Nobody ever came. It's difficult to arrest 85 old lady, right? Or even to steal a plants from the garden. And make no mistakes. I mean, this group 60 plus is actually our primary target group in many of the illnesses. In the algaziology, definitely. In the oncology, definitely. The neurology might be a little bit different, but not that much. The Alzheimer's, again, Alzheimer's disease is again an illness of higher age cohorts. So I think this is important. I mean, to see these are no punks. These are no irresponsible parents. These are no freaks. These are all people who are just trying to improve the quality of their lives. And maybe they believe in some more, but this is definitely what they do.
I already said it in my talk that a case of cannabis treatment, this is a case where we studied from our patients. We learned from them how to use it. I learned it from my post-traumatic patients, from our Israeli veterans. We have a lot of veterans of our war in the Middle East, and from terrorist attacks. We have a lot of veterans, and those people, they have a pain, depression, post-trauma. They need to fight them. They found the treatment. We just needed to listen to them, to appreciate the way for treat themselves. So the first company in Israel were established by the veterans, and they had the license to produce cannabis for themselves. So it was no NGO that produced cannabis for themselves. By them the growers were learned to use cannabis for themselves. So it was classical self-treatment approved by the authorities, but they also had to distribute it to other patients because much more applications had come. So this is a classical way we learn from our patients, we learn from their experience that it could be helpful for other patients. And now they have much more than several thousand patients treated. So this is a way where we clinicians were led by our patients. And now we learn from them. I have nothing to teach my patients. I have much to do with their relatives, with their parents, how to assure them, how to say them that patients receive cannabis under a good follow-up, under the medical responsibility. This is calming all caregivers, all parents, and the family members. So we need to work in a close cooperation, providing our medical attention to them, learning from them, and in such cooperation, we reduce all suspicious rate, insurance rate. We just need to reduce our doctors from the throne, saying that we are gods. No. We just need to learn from our patients, to work with patients' associations. This is a main question, how will be the quality of our collaboration with patients' association, because we have some patients' association in Israel, NGOs, that would provide very good kind of assistance, guidance, instruction for drug-naive patients, for cannabis-naive patients, for their families. So we need to have a patient's patients' collaboration with them. We should patients have fight for their rights to be treated by the doctors, and doctors should fight for their rights to provide good quality assessment and treatment for their patients. But patient advocacy are not a doctor advocacy. We have different directions that should be appreciated. We should work in close collaboration, and this is why I would like to encourage you to create in your country and patient NGOs, patient association, and doctor association, working with good collaboration. Thank you.
So as Miklós mentioned, that for most patients, the right time to have access to medicine is yesterday. So they always want to have access now, and they don't want to hear that, okay, let's wait for that clinical trials, and then we can provide you some standardized medicines. But medical professionals prefer to prescribe, you know, standardized medicines. So, and even if in some countries there is access to like Sativex, which is a spray, but some patients say that that is too expensive, and we would like to use our own cheaper natural cannabis plant. So how do you see this this dilemma, or what can do about that?
Thank you for letting me speak. Well, sure, while we're speaking about medical treatment, it should be standardized. We try to standardize it now, but it is difficult because, like Thomas said, we have a sentient world, Hypericum, this is a plant, as a plant material, it could be supplied to the patients to the safe manner. We know everything about this plant. We don't know exactly what kind of thousands of molecules, how it works. But it doesn't prevent us from providing it as a good quality receptor for the patients with mild depression. So I consider it as a, you know, improved placebo. But it helps for, it works for many patients. Why not to do it? So we need to try to standardize our treatment to understand better what we are doing in order to improve our ability to provide them better quality treatment, to find new administrative form, to find better dosages, dosage strategies. But it could, putting in consideration that it could not fit for each particular patient. So we need to construct some kind of individualized treatment because of the plant features, because of these plant features, because of the phytotherapy. But we need to educate us before we are doing this. I'm sure that Professor Hanush have
Professor Hanush, would you like to say something?
I think that they mentioned everything. But concerning Sativex, I'm not for Sativex. It's expensive, and we can produce the naturally Sativex. Look, in Israel, 8 growers each produce between 1 and 2 tons a year. All together, what I collected informations, all together, this was about 260 different strains. So, and Bedrocan has just 4 strains.
5
now. 5 are. Sorry, I apologize them. So they have 5 strains. We have more than 200, so I'm sure that between these strains are better strains that they have. And there are many strains which are 50-50, like Sativex, and in different levels, in different percentage of these two main compounds, CBD and THC. And it's very cheap, so. If I am right, in Czech Republic, nobody bought any Sativex, yeah?
No, 3 people.
3 people, because it was 14,000 crowns, yes?
24 per month.
24? 24. And pension is...
1,000 euros.
Yeah, and pension is between 9 and 11,000, about, yes?
Not really. Not at all.
Nope.
Half of it.
Also lower. Okay. So simply they cannot reach it.
Okay. I mean, this is probably my final, so I might be a little bit longer, but feel free to interrupt me anytime. I mean, Sativex is fine. Expensive. There are people who can afford it. There are people who fit into their insurance schemes, and there are people who definitely actually benefit of it. For me, this is only 2-molecular preparation, which means there are limitations. Using the example from the Czech Republic, unfortunately not a proper research, and because of personal reasons there might be none. However, Czech Republic was one of the sites where the GW Pharmaceuticals did all the stages of the Sativex clinical trials. There have been several hundreds of patients. And the results, the general, as I know it from the coordinator, from the Czech coordinator of the studies, was 30% basically resistant, 30% some improvement, 30% actually quite dramatic improvement in terms of improving the quality of life. Less clonicity, less spasms, less pains, better ability to take care for themselves, better ability to walk, name it. I was speaking, and you might remember this seminar from 2010. There was the lady who was the head, who unfortunately left us like 3 weeks ago, but she was the head of the, she was a fighter. And she was the head of the organization which calls themselves ROSKA, from the Czech Roztroušená Skleróza, so that was a kind of abbreviation. And it was the like a loose association of patients, mostly female, which is interesting, with multiple sclerosis, who said, and I'm treating myself with medical cannabis. And many of them were actually part of this trial, of these clinical trials during the, and many of them were for the 30% of totally resistant for the Sativex. And according to this lady and according to a few dozens of patients I actually tried to interview, about 60% of those Sativex resistant patients benefited from the cannabis, which was actually somehow provided more or less the same strain, because somebody said, okay, this helped me. So I think Sativex is fine, but it's lacking what I personally do believe should be the change of the paradigm, and that's the entourage effect. I mean, I'm always saying, okay, I'm a psychiatrist and medical doctor by training, but my background is epidemiology, biostatistics, and public health. And this changed a little bit my medical perspective, because in the epidemiology, we don't need to understand perfectly how something works. For us, there's enough to know it does work, you know? And I think what that this is where we are, and this is the fight of the paradigms. And again, I mean, Bedrocan with their fabulously stable strains is okay. It should be there. They should go their way. The Israel with a little bit more loose than the Dutch approach, with much more of self supporting groups, which much more of experiments, which wouldn't be allowed in Netherlands and in my country, with much closer relationship between the growers and the patients, with very little interference of doctors, at least till very recently, is yet another model. And I think we can again learn from it and benefit, and both should live together, right? And the problem with doctors who are more economically being pushed to see the patient, there's a pill, bye. There's a pill, bye. There's a pill, bye. Oh, temperature increase, there's two pills, bye. And they, so where, dear Lumiere, you find a space to psychologically interact with your patient, if there's the insurance company telling, oh, there's two more minutes, you're penalized. So there are other problems, you know. This is not only that medical doctors are idiots, we are not, but there are economic incentives, there are an economic environment, I mean, they have to operate in, and other pressures, not to speak about stupid politicians, which every country has abundance of, I'm pretty sure. So I mean, then we should be also a little bit realistic, you know, I mean, and somehow to compare the dreams with the environment. And here I stay. Thank you for the attention.
Yeah, I would just add that, you know, the reality is that people are using cannabis as a medicine today and breaking the law all over the world. And actually, for a period of time, when I was living in California in 2002, I was a legal patient, and then I moved. I'll see you on Friday. and then I moved to Washington, D.C. to open up the national headquarters of Americans for Safe Access, and my use became illegal again. And so I was breaking the law to use this medicine. And I think we've taken two approaches at Americans for Safe Access. One is we give patients the information that they need to understand what laws they're breaking and what to do if they break those laws. I mean, and I'm not saying that that's the way I want things to be, but realistically, if you're out there saying that there's this cure, there's this possibility, and then patients are going out and looking for it themselves, then as a patient advocacy group, I think it's our role to say, these are exactly the laws you're going to be breaking, this is what you can expect in court, and it's, you know, until we change those laws. And then on the other hand, for patients that are trying to get in this program, you have to let them know of all options that are available. So there is the possibility that people can, their doctors can write a prescription for Bedrocan here in Hungary. That there are these pathways, and it may not be the perfect solution, but from the point of view of governments, if they don't hear that there's a problem, then there's no problem. So if you look at the program in Germany, there were hundreds of patients enrolling in the program to get Bedrocan imported into Germany. And so the bureaucrats were like, oh my, there's so much paperwork. You know, there's now 300 patients that are getting this imported. And so it became an issue for them as well. And that's why it was really the change in the law in Germany came from recommendations from the Department of Health, from the bureaucrats that were like, this is not sustainable for us to be importing this expensive product instead of us growing it alone. So even if it's not a perfect system, if there's any way that the Hungarian government can see that there's a need that they cannot meet by simple importation, that's what's going to change the law the fastest. Even if it's not the perfect answer for a patient, getting doctors to write those prescriptions and getting those prescriptions on the desks, on your desk, will push this program faster.
Thank you. I hope that this occasion could be a proof or an evidence for that the Hungarian authority is enough open, and we would like to build bridges between healthcare professionals and the patient, and between the law. So thank you very much for this occasion.
Thank you very much for the statement. And this time I would like to ask if there is any questions or comments of the audience. Professor Andrei, probably.
I believe the time is, as the colleague said, from the OG or whatever the agency, that the time is more than ripe in Hungary. Well, recently there has been a consultation in the parliament on cannabis cultivation. How to revive cannabis cultivation, are you aware of it? Well, that is too pity, too bad. But there was an extensive consultation, I was also part of it, and what I can see, there is a revival of interest in cultivating whatever kind of cannabis for CBD, for whatever. I had already here approaches because they heard that I was part of the discussion. But it has to be a specific point that including medicinal cannabis, revival of cultivation not only for fiber and oil, fatty oil from the seed and all kinds of other products, because cannabis is fantastic, has many products used by men, but including maybe a special type for medical purposes. That will be not an easy job. It will be a complicated job, a difficult job, and it is not going to be the easiest way for authorization. But as we have heard, this may be still a viable way. Thank you.
One more
comment. I am just preparing an update review. I have informed periodically the clinical science neurologists, clinical neuroscience in the journal. Periodically, I informed them all the progress 3 years ago, 6 years ago, and I'm going to make a new update summarizing all the recent results. But this is obviously, this has to be a science-based review on the new progress, because they are totally unaware. The last paper has elicited a number of calls and interests, etc. They are still reluctant, but I think it is also part of the educational process.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sandri. Ilya?
I would like to say that speaking about medicinal cannabis, we should understand that cannabis as a plant just doesn't know if it's medicinal or not. It's just a plant. So we just use a plant for our medical purposes. We need to know how to use it. Simply know, as a medicine, as a functional medicine, we have a sativex, but also we have a plant medicine. Cannabis itself does not understand it's for medical use or not for medical use. So this is why I do not like the words medical cannabis, because cannabis is a plant. Cannabis is a plant that does not know what kind of use. We are making it medical. Following this logic, the whole issue of indications is just in vain. I do not suppose that we have a real indication to use a plant medicine. How? If this is an unspecific drug, unspecific medicine. We use it as a medicine. So this is why I understand this whole issue to find indications, to approve indication, to find scientific evidences is just in vain. We will waste our resources and time, very expensive time, and public resources, time for the critically ill patients, for in vain. Why? Because there is no real indications for cannabis could be exist. We just need to be able to suggest it to any patients that we could be benefit from it. And because cannabis, this is a short-acting drug, I'm speaking about analgesic properties, antidepressive properties, anti-anxiety properties, anti-inflammatory properties. We could see it very easily for another short trial if it's benefit or not. And maybe other strain will be more benefit, but we should not put it for the first line of the treatment, because all association, or British Association of Pain Medicine, American Association, Israel Association, they placed cannabis as a fifth line of treatment. So it's saying that it could be suggested on the patient only after all available options are used. No, it's just a wrong assumption. We need to be able to suggest it to our patient from the very beginning, placing it without any indications that could be existed. This is an unspecific drug, and I hope that your patients in your country will have a much easier access to this drug.
Well, I fully agree with Dr. Resnick that there is no medicinal cannabis, technical cannabis, recreational cannabis. These are just artificial names. It's only one cannabis, cannabis sativa, linea, what is hemp. And only differences in amount and ratio of cannabinoid compounds is the only difference. And you must understand that what we call today medicinal cannabis, so most of these strain, these are strain which were developed for recreational use. So this was recreational cannabis, but today it's called medicinal cannabis. And so I think also cannot be forgotten what is called in the United States hemp. It means cannabis which is used in industry, which has low contents of cannabinoid compounds, because one of my friend, he treated multiple sclerosis with regular medicine. It cost him 18,000 euro each year without any results. Then father told him, try marijuana. So he tried marijuana. Oh, he was on wheelchairs, just one puff, he get up. And he told me, oh, look here, one puff and I walk 1 mile, 1.6 kilometer today. So I am like healthy. So it is wonderful. So he saw that the most important is the highest amount of THC. So he was trying to find high THC strains. Then he came to Southern Moravia. There is wild cannabis. What I check, it's 0.8% CBD, 0.3% THC. He tried it. Oh, it worked perfect. He said, unbelievable. I needn't buy it. I can just pick up it in the nature. So must be everything used and check if it works. Everybody must find his correct strain. So it doesn't mean that it's high THC or high CBD. Everybody must just find what works for his disease.
So as we see more and more countries and states in the US are legalizing the recreational use of cannabis. So how do you see the future? And I think this will happen in many other countries in the future. And if in a country recreational cannabis use is legalized, does it make sense to create a separate system for access to medical cannabis when everybody can just walk to the cannabis store and buy different strains of cannabis? Does it make sense to regulate it separately? That's my question.
I get asked this question a lot. And the truth is, as Amir was saying, that it's a plant. Whether you're going to build a house out of it, whether you're going to go to a concert when using it, or if you're going to take it as a medicine, right? It's still the same plant. So the questions that we've answered for society of how to safely get that plant to humans for human consumption is the same, right? So how to cultivate it so that there are no contaminants, that there's no bacteria, how to manufacture it so that there's no contaminants, that's the same. But the distribution is different, and here's why I believe this. One is that the medicine that are the what patients want out of a plant is often very different than what a recreational user wants. So for a one-to-one ratio of CBD to THC, that's not going to be fun at a concert. You know, whatever the recreational desire is from cannabis, CBD actually brings down that feeling. So it's not the same actual end result product. And also patients use a lot more than what a recreational user uses. So we have to find out a way that this can be affordable for patients, that they can get insurance coverage. But I think more importantly, this is where the question of standardization is gonna come, right? You know, if you, for many patients, we're not looking for the next best strain of cannabis. What we're really looking for is once we find a strain or a product that works, we want the same thing. We want the same thing every time. And that comes from standardization. And what you see with recreational users is it's more boutique, right? They want to try, like when you go to a bar that has 20 beers, you know, the recreational users, they want something different every time. They're not necessarily looking for the same thing. So I think the markets are different and what the individuals want out of the products are different. And I think what we're seeing right now in this experiment in the United States is the recreational industry is actually as aggressively gone after the medical cannabis industry and tried to get rid of or weaken the medical cannabis laws because they want higher profits from their sales of marijuana. So I don't think that I would never depend on a beer manufacturer for my medicine. And I think the same is true when we look at these laws. Okay.
Although I know beer is medicine in Czech Republic.
No.
Any comments?
I want just tell you that, of course, cannabis must have medicinal quality. It's without any doubt. But I wish that it goes in Hungary how it went in Macedonia, because in Czech Republic, it was in Czechoslovakia used all the time, and it took us very intensive 7 years of seminars and TV, radio, newspapers. Then it was legalized. 2 years ago, we had for the first time seminar in Skopje in Macedonia. There were 500 persons in the hall and 300 were outside because they didn't have chance enter, even when it was free of charge. Last year was second seminar, and 3 days ago was seminar in Macedonia in Skopje, and cannabis is already legal. They can use, they are not going to use plant material, but extract what somebody called Rick Simpson oil or Phoenix steel, I call it extract, and without any limit THC. If it has 99% THC, no problem. So they can use it in medicine. So it was really very fast. It took them only 2 years. So I wish that something like that happens in Hungary, and that is accessible for patients to whom physicians cannot help, but the cannabis can be very helpful.
I would like to say that for me it's probably two separate direction. Legalizing, this is a social issue, political issue, it is a could be an agenda of each society, like this society would like to categorize it. And different matter, the cannabis for medical use, it should be have a very easy access to this. I would like also to invite you to look for web for declaration, medical cannabis declaration. This is a declaration that was had been issued by our association, International Association for Medical Cannabis. I would like to invite you and to ask to sign this declaration having 2 points. Each patient has his own right to be available for cannabis, and the cannabis should be available to him, and another for reasonable, good quality, for reasonable price. And second point, that all doctors that wish to work in this field have should have this access to recommend or to prescribe cannabis for each patient that he suggests it's suitable for this treatment under his medical legal responsibility. And follow up, etc., under good clinical practice category. So this is a 2-point declaration. I would like you ask you to visit this website and to sign it. This is a worldwide initiative. Now it's crowdfunding in order to be available to all governments and policymakers. I suppose this is a good initiative, and I hope that your government also will be available to our declaration. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and our time is soon up, so I just would like to give you a last round of, let's say, recommendations for Hungarian activists who are seeking to fight for this cause. What do you recommend them?
No, I think that Hungarian activists are doing a good job. It's important that the other side listen, and that it goes to the practical life. This is not depend activists, they are doing their best. So now it's ball on the other side. So I hope that other side is going to listen and change the situation which is now.
I would say today was a really great start, and I think the next steps is really staying in touch and looking at a strategic roadmap of how to move forward. There are a lot of resources that are available to countries today that were not available 2 years ago, and so I would say make sure that you understand what it takes to actually regulate medical cannabis, which means there's an agricultural component, there's a manufacturing component, and there's an education component for doctors and patients. And you don't have to wait for the law to change to begin doing the other education. So, and then stay in touch with us. We'd love to help.
Thank you for letting me to conclude our panel. We really hope that such kind of meetings have some impact of authorities and those who should listen to this and to accept important decisions concerning the cannabis as a available medical options for patients, and also for doctors not to be frightened to work in this field, to be educated properly. And I hope that we have Steph said, step in the right direction, and I encourage you to be more active, to speak with your doctors, to educate them, not to shy to say this openly. Now we live, all of us, we are living in democratic society, not totalitarian one that it has been before. So don't be frightened, stay on your rights, and I wish you good luck.
Thank you very much, and let's join me thanking the excellent panelists.
És akkor az én végső kötelezettségem, my last duty, is to thank everyone who made this event possible. Hogy megköszönjem mindenkinek azt, aki ezt az eseményt lehetővé tette, de elsőképpen azoknak, akik nélkül nem jöhetett volna ma létre ez a beszélgetés, és ezek a tolmácsaink, akik reggel 9 óra óta folyamatosan lehetővé teszik számunkra, hogy értsük egymást. Úgyhogy először is tapsoljuk meg őket nagyon. És szeretném megköszönni az előadóinknak, akik itt voltak. Sokat utaznak ők, és nagyon köszönjük, hogy az eléggé telelévő napirendjükbe még beleillesztették Budapestet is. Szeretném megköszönni a hazai előadóknak is, akik közül nem kevesen rizikót vállaltak azzal, hogy most itt a nyilvánosság előtt elmondták a saját élményeiket, a véleményüket, a szakmai álláspontukat. Csak megerősíteni tudom, hogy ez egy csak a kezdete az útnak. A TASZ-ról azt tudom mondani, hogy mi ezt folytatjuk. Több eseményt tervezünk szervezni érintetteknek, az orvos és az egészségügyi szakmának, illetve mindenképpen igyekszünk majd még elhozni ezeket a szakembereket Budapestre, és reméljük, hogy előbb-utóbb a minisztérium is tiszteletét teszi, és tudunk velük találkozni. És akkor még szeretném megköszönni az egész szervezésben a közreműködést a csodálatos kollégáimnak, akik elintézték, hogy legyen kávé, legyen szendvics, hogy legyen minden a helyén, illetve a TASZ önkénteseinek, akik közül többen itt voltak ma, és segítettek nekünk. Szeretném még megköszönni Sárosi Péternek, hogy bevállalta a moderálást, és a donorainknak, akik anyagilag lehetővé tették a mai eseményt, és nem csak anyagilag tették lehetővé, hanem más módokon is támogatják a munkánkat. Úgyhogy én ezzel most nagyon sok történettel és ismerettel gazdagodva, és rettenetesen sok erőt érezve a folytatáshoz bezárom a mai napot, és köszönöm mindenkinek, akik itt voltak, és végighallgatták az előadásokat.